Welcome back, our dear viewers. As we have promised at the beginning of the show, we are going to talk today about the Egyptian foreign policy in light of the recent visits. We have received many visits here in Egypt recently. We have witnessed a visit by a U.S. congressional delegation to Egypt. They met with President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. Also, the Mauritanian President Mohamed Ould Abdel Aziz did visit Egypt, the first visit, official visit, by a Mauritanian president to Egypt in 40 years. And he did meet also with President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. He was awarded the merit of the Nile as well. And we are expecting a historical visit next Thursday by the custodian of the two holy shrines, King Salman bin Abdel Aziz, to Egypt. And also by the end of the month, we are expecting a visit by French President François Hollande to Egypt. What are the significance of this visit and how these visits could help Egypt and the whole region? We are going to talk about this issue with our dear guest in the studio, Ms. Hedayat Abdel Nabi, the editor-in-chief of People's Rights magazine. Good morning.
Good morning to you both.
Good morning, Ms. Hedayat. Let's first begin with the visit of the U.S. Congress delegation, as the President Fattah al-Sisi received the delegation under South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham in the presence of Foreign Minister Sameh Shoukry and the U.S. ambassador to Egypt. Let's first focus on the significance of this visit.
Well, this visit is extremely important. Congressional delegations are important because you have to lobby Congress. They formulate foreign policy in the United States. I mean, they are the people who vote on agreements for military aid, for bilateral aid, for many things. So if they are on your side, then it's a good thing. Lately, I think we need a boost in Egyptian-American relations. We need a shot in the arm to help it regain its health again. But really, the declarations of Congressman Lindsey were very, very important. I mean, to come out from a congressman whose mass media, in a way, the American mass media, has a certain spot on Egypt, sometimes say a little bit negative sometimes. Then he comes out and says that President El-Sisi is the right man for Egypt, that Egypt is so important for the United States. He says also that President Sisi is important because he consolidates the rule of law, human rights, and the fight against terrorism. These are very important declarations at this moment in time.
Indeed. Ms. Hedayat, how do you see the statements and the outcome of the visit after meeting with President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi by the U.S. congressional delegations? And do you believe that we are going to witness a real change or a boost in the bilateral relations between Egypt and the United States in the coming period?
Well, we have a period between now and the American elections in November, which is going to be a period of wait and see. Because we have to wait for the next president of the United States and see who's the next president will be. I think it is an important period. We have a couple of months that we can make a lot of delegations to go and visit the United States, to meet with the nominees for president. To receive a lot of delegations here. It's a good period that you can invest properly in.
Ms. Hedayat, do you expect to witness a real change in the Egyptian-American relations after the election of the new American president? Because it's not so much clear, but I believe up till this moment the choices is narrowing between Clinton and Donald Trump. So do you believe that we are going to see a real shift? Either Clinton or Trump did win the elections.
Well, I really don't know. I can't predict at this moment.
But do you expect to see a change in the policy of the United States towards Egypt and the whole region after the Obama regime?
Well, Clinton might move in the same path like President Obama with some modifications. Probably it will be positive. Because, of course, she knows the importance of Egypt. And when she was Secretary of State, the 25th Revolution took place in Egypt. So she is aware of the nitties and gritties of Egyptian politics. And I think that she will be rather positive in her dealing with Egypt. Mr. Trump, as you see him, is a very forceful man.
Yeah.
He says what he says and he does what he wants. Yeah. And he's unpredictable, so I cannot really judge.
The issue of human rights was also tackled during the meeting with the U.S. congressional delegation. And how can we attain a balance between national security and stability in Egypt on one hand and rights and freedoms on the other?
Well, I suppose from the declarations of Congressman Lindsey Graham, you can feel that he came out confident that the President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi, outlined the balance between safeguarding human rights and the problems of security and terrorism and etc. And I think the president has highlighted this issue in a number of meetings, especially with the intellectuals of Egypt. So he came out satisfied, so that is good. It means that the president is the number one authority in Egypt that upholds the notion of human rights. And that's very good for Egypt.
Yes. Indeed. Ms. Hedayat, tonight by the Egyptian local time and in the afternoon by the American local time, we are going to see the Wisconsin elections for both candidates for the Republicans and Democrats. Do you believe that these choices by the Americans would lead to real change in their policies towards the Middle East region and all the development taking place? How do you see the repercussions of these choices on the region?
Well, until tomorrow, I mean, the results will be clear tomorrow morning about the Wisconsin primaries because of the time difference. As we know, it's Clinton versus Bernie Sanders for the Democrats, and for the Republicans, it's Trump, Cruz, and Casey. I'm not sure that Casey will do well. The battle will be between Trump and Cruz for the Republicans. For the Democrats, as we know that Hillary Clinton is now campaigning in New York, and it was questioned yesterday, why is she leaving Wisconsin? Is it because she's expecting that Bernie Sanders will take over Wisconsin? And her answer, I think, was that not her answer, it was an answer by a spokesperson for Mrs. Clinton, said that she did her homework in Wisconsin. She was there last
week. And she moved on to New York.
And she moved on to New York. Wisconsin, you have 81 delegates to win in Wisconsin. Mrs. Clinton is far ahead of Mr. Bernie Sanders. And concerning politics in the region, I really don't know that there will be a great change if Mrs. Clinton becomes the President of the United States. Because, as you know, she went and spoke to AIPAC. And her declarations at AIPAC was that the security of Israel is non-negotiable, which were very harsh statements, which really led to dismay among many Arabs and Egyptians who have a certain...
So you don't think there will be any change in the U.S.
I don't know, but
policy in the Middle East, even after electing a new president?
Well, these are basic policies, I mean, that don't change with the change of a president, unless if he's an Eisenhower. You know, you remember Eisenhower when
he
asked for the withdrawal of all troops from the Suez Canal area in 1956. So I'm not sure that there will be a great change, because currently the forecast is that probably Mrs. Clinton will become the nominee of the Democratic Party.
Yes, indeed.
And probably, if it's not a contested convention, Mr. Trump will be the nominee of the Republican Party. Mr. Trump had certain statements which were not bad when he said, I would be neutral concerning a deal between the Palestinians and the Israelis. And then he went to speak to AIPAC and turned all this upside down again and allied himself completely with Israel. So I think this is basic tenets of American foreign policy. Mm-hmm. It doesn't change with the change of a president. Indeed. I think it's our homework to force American foreign policy to take a new angle.
Mm, of course. Also, fighting terrorism was topping the agenda of President Fatah Sisi's meeting with the U.S. Congress delegation. I think that we should adopt new strategies in combating terrorism, like uprooting poverty and taking more care of education. So what do you think of this?
Well, the grassroots of terrorism lie in poverty and disenfranchised people yes. who have mm-hmm. no rights and people who are suffering in yeah. their life. Unfortunately, in Europe, the people who are carrying terrorist attacks are from Arab origin, born in Europe. And I would say that they live much better in Europe than in their countries, mm. in their original states. And therefore, it's such a shame that these people have diverted to a criminal path.
Mm. It's not poverty only, you mean that?
No, no, it's poverty, but because there in Europe, there is a difference in the standard of yes. living of the normal European mm. who is born from a European origin and... an Arab who is born there. There is a difference in yes. their lives. So if they compare and they look around and they see the difference, they become very people who are disgruntled. They don't like what they're living in. Although the reason why their parents left because they lived very badly yes. in the Middle, the Arab Middle East. So for Egypt, I think... social justice is important so that we don't feed the extremist ideologies among the people. Mm-hmm. I think that education is very important, and all the social services that should be given to a human being are extremely important to result in a human being who's in full equilibrium. And I hope we'll be doing this in this year and in the coming years.
Hopefully. Ms. Hedayat, can we shed more light about the expected visit by the custodian of the two holy shrine, King Salman, to Egypt, which is expected to take place next Thursday? What's the importance of such a visit to Egypt and the timing of the visit as well?
Extremely important. Mm. The custodian of the holy mosques is, Egypt and Saudi Arabia are the two countries that form an alliance in a coalition in the region yes. that is so important for stability and peace. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I think it's going to result in many agreements, mm-hmm. Very beneficial for economic development, for economic growth. Mm. And then it will also cement the relationship between the two countries. Mm. And I think that the Saudi ambassador has written a Twitter saying that the King of Saudi Arabia is visiting his second country in a couple of days, and it flagged beautifully on Twitter. Yeah. So he's coming to his second country, and he will be received as a very important Saudi Egyptian.
Indeed. Mm.
And can you tell us more, Mrs. Hedayat, your take on the Mauritanian president's visit to Egypt and the importance of this visit and the agreements that were signed?
Well, as you said in your introduction, that nobody visited Egypt from Mauritania yes. for 40 years. That's a very long time.
Very long time.
Very long time for brotherly relations not to have a yes. visit in 40 years. So probably it's good on time that he came, because the Arab summit will be, I think, hosted in Mauritania. Yes. He was also decorated by the president with the highest Egyptian order, which is the Nile order. Mm. And there were 6 agreements signed. Mm. All beneficial to both countries, I mean.
So I think in the field of agriculture and livestock.
Yeah, and oil and gas and a number of other, and also in construction, and there were 6 agreements anyway. Yes. All these things are good. I mean, it's good movement. Mm.
How do you see the expected also visit next by the end of the month by President of France, François Hollande? So we are seeing a visit here by an African leader, the President of Mauritania, the custodian of the Two Holy Shrine, and the French President, François Hollande, the President of France. So how do you see the significance of all these visits at this short period, and what are their significance to Egypt?
Well, first, it highlights the importance of Egypt to the world.
Yes.
Number one, you have an African angle, an Arab angle, and a European angle.
Indeed.
If you take the European angle and speak about the Hollande visit, I think it's extremely important.
Indeed.
Because it comes after the Brussels terrorist attacks, and of course we know the relationship, the close relationship between France and Belgium, and the cooperation in combating terrorism, and the situation in Egypt, where the president of Egypt is combating also terrorism and helping other countries to succeed in this battle. So I think the visit will be extremely important in liaising between France and Egypt, and in discussing future plans to combat terrorism, in addition to the so many agreements that will result from the visit, which probably will be mostly in the sphere of economics. Of course, we know we have strong military cooperation with France, France is one of the P5s in the Security Council, one of the 5 countries that have the veto right in the Security Council. So it's an extremely important visit.
Of course.
So in your opinion, what is the effect of all these visits on the Egyptian economy?
Well, the more you have bilateral agreements, the more you have projects, the more you have
investments,
opportunity for people to work. This is very good for the economy.
Yes.
And of course, as you mentioned, it means investment inside Egypt. And I think it's very important because you have Saudi Arabia is the richest country in the Arab world.
Yes.
Probably competes with 1 or 2 other countries in the world for being number one.
Actually, there is a plan. Saudi investments in Egypt is to reach £60 billion.
Well, Saudi Arabia is very, very, very important in terms of economic wealth and power. And France is very, very important in terms of our bilateral relations and our regional cooperation, especially in the case of the Palestinian issue. If we're talking about the American scene, well, France is very pro a two-state solution between Israel and Palestine. Mm. And therefore, that's another dimension of the visit, that we think that it could result in more understanding of how to lobby other countries in favor of the two-state solution. All these movements and visits are important in strengthening the core of the Egyptian economy.
Indeed. Dr. Hedayat, what steps should be taken in the coming phase in the Egyptian foreign policy in order to benefit on the economic front and on the political front in order to move forward in our economy and in our foreign policy?
That's a very big question and issue. I think it's bigger than my knowledge of the situation. But anyway,
because now we are opening new fronts, maybe we are having more existence, more presence on the African front, and maybe in many Eastern countries as well. So we are opening new venues of cooperation with
Of course,
states.
You have seen the president moving from Asia to Europe to Africa. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's doing a lot of work for mm-hmm. Egypt. The foreign minister has visited many countries also. Mm-hmm. I feel we are on the right track. So do I have any proposition? No, I don't. Maybe if we were not on the right track, I would have said I would propose this and this and that. But since we are on the right track and we have become again part of the International Parliamentary Union, IPU, and this was very welcome.
Indeed.
I really don't have any suggestions on that level.
Mm. So you feel that we are doing good steps?
Yes, of course.
Approaching our relations with many countries which have been neglected for years, I believe.
Well, Africa is the continent that was neglected
Indeed.
For years.
Yeah. So do you think that Egypt now is regaining its pivotal role in the African continent with the visit of the Mauritanian president to Egypt and other leaders who came to visit Egypt from Africa?
Well, Egypt is pivotal in Africa because, you know, we played a very important role in the liberation movement in Africa during the time of late President Gamal Abdel Nasser.
Indeed, yes.
I think that the more you receive heads of states, the better. But I would prefer, maybe here, I would prefer to people-to-people diplomacy.
Yes.
I would prefer that more delegations would visit Africa, which are not official delegations. Businessmen, members of the Human Rights Council, members of parliament.
Which is still not very much the case up to this moment.
Yes. And I would prefer that kind of interaction. Maybe I would like to see a number of fora to discuss African relations to be held, you know, in the summer, somewhere in Sharm el Sheikh or Alexandria or the coast, and to open venues of new fields of cooperation.
Indeed.
Because if we say that the relations were tight and very close during the period of late President Gamal Abdel Nasser, and then there was a lull, of course, we have to say that during the period when Dr. Boutros Ghali, God bless his soul and he rest in peace, was Minister of State for Foreign Affairs, he had a lot of emphasis on Africa, and he had very close relations with Africa. But today, all the countries have developed. There are new venues, there are new opportunities. So we have to explore all this, and we have to work on it.
Indeed. Ms. Hedayat, as we are still talking about Africa, we have to admit here that the Egyptian-African relations were not at its best during the past 30 years, or maybe less, but Africa has been neglected by Egypt. And we have seen some cold relationships between Egypt and its neighbors in Africa. So what should be taken now into consideration in order to resume the Egyptian role in Africa, not only on the political front, but cultural front, touristic front, because we do not see many African tourists come to Egypt. We do not see many Egyptians going to Africa to visit Africa. We do not see many cooperation on the cultural front as well. So how can we do that?
Well, I think maybe the best way to do it is through the cultural front, because then it is financed by the Egyptian state, the delegations that would go. I would open cooperation with universities in Africa. I mean Cairo University and Shams University, other universities. Maybe we can also offer scholarships for African scholars, students in Egyptian universities. A lot of these things could open new avenues.
Ms. Hedayat, how do you see the role of Al-Azhar here? Because Al-Azhar is supposed to be playing a very important role in that field, in particular of educating people and of sending Al-Azhar scholars to Africa in order also to clarify and give the real image of Islam
in the African states, as well as the fact that they are spreading the knowledge of Al-Azhar there. Many students from many African states do come and study in Al-Azhar here. So how do you see the role of Al-Azhar in that field?
Well, it's an extremely important role, and you have many, many African students from Muslim African countries who come to Al-Azhar to be taught, you know, moderate Islam and Islam. And, well, it's always welcome to have delegations going from here, from Al-Azhar to Africa, of course.
This is Hedayat Abdel Nabi, editor-in-chief of People's Rights Magazine. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you
very much for your precious input, and have a lovely morning.
Thank you very much.
And now, dear viewers, we'll go to visit one of the historical places here in Egypt with our colleague Dina Yunus, who's stay tuned.